Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, Universal 1944. We've got an interesting double feature for you, Weird Woman and Cobra Woman.
We're really getting away from politics at last with this 1944 episode.
Well, I would argue that we're getting pretty in-depth into politics, at least with Cobra Woman, but we'll talk about that.
You think there's a Nazi allegory in Cobra Woman?
Undoubtedly.
Okay. If so, it's a pretty blatant one.
Before we do any of that, let's hear from Joel W. Findler, The Hollywood Story. He's got his big pink chart of all of the contract players at Universal in 1944. He gives them ratings of 1, 2, or 3 stars based on his subjective impression of how important they were to the studio during the length of their contract. Lon Chaney Jr., 1 star, very relevant to both movies this week. Maria Montez, 2 stars.
That's interesting because she had a bunch of huge hits for them, including this one.
Absolutely, she did. Abbott and Costello, 3 stars.
Ugh.
Donald O'Connor, 1 star. Sabu is relevant to our episode this week because he's in Cobra Woman, but apparently he wasn't under contract in 44, from 42 to 43, and again from 46 to 48. But he made a movie in 44, which we are going to discuss, so let's throw him in. 2 stars. Deanna Durbin with 3 stars, and Basil Rathbone, 1 star. That's it.
Not really star-studded.
No.
Not the House of Stars, Universal.
No, and that's been the case from the beginning. They do things on a shoestring. There are various owners, but they all have similar constraints upon their ability to operate. Of course, that's going to change radically in the 50s, and Universal is now probably the biggest existing studio. A lot of their television operations are going to enrich them considerably, but that's for deep into the future and beyond the scope of the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, because we stop in 1948. So now we're going to get into the Universal Story, written by Clive Hirshhorn. As people may know, if you've been listening for the past few months, we're now trying to work in the write-ups on the studio itself during the year in question, whenever the coffee table book deigns to discuss such things. And unfortunately, Clive Hirshhorn did not do that, so we don't have a pithy report on the state of things at Universal in 1944. So all we have are individual write-ups. Weird Woman is one of the 10 or 15 that got shunted into They Also Made These. So there's a one-sentence practically review in here on it. Producer Oliver Drake, director Reginald Borg, and the write-up, Inner Sanctum Mystery, in which newlyweds Lon Chaney Jr. and Anne Gwynn return to a small town where jealous Evelyn Ankers begins a smear campaign against them, resulting in murder and suicide, also with Ralph Morgan. 62 minutes long.
Well, that's interesting that it was only worth that much of a write-up, and I guess it didn't even register for Leonard Maltin.
Oh yeah, it's in Maltin.
Oh, it's in Maltin?
Do you want to hear Maltin?
Haven't you been doing Maltins for this series?
I haven't, but I agree, because that was such a short one, let's have Maltin for Weird Woman.
I thought you would always try to bring in Maltin at every opportunity, but I don't even keep track of what you're doing every week.
No, I haven't been combining Maltin with the coffee table books, only when we're not doing the studios year by year.
I think and hope that listeners know what our weekly routine is better than I do.
Elise's just here.
Just for the discussion, that's all I'm tuning in for.
Has Elise ever listened to the podcast? Of course not.
No, I get self-conscious. I'm here for the process, not the product.
So Leonard Maltin gives Weird Woman 2.5 stars, and he does give a slightly longer description. Lon Chaney's ex-girlfriend objects to his Tropic Isle bride, connives to get even. Way out entry in the Inner Sanctum series, based on Fritz Lieber's Conjure Wife. is good fun, with anchors in nice change of pace villainous role, remade as Burn Witch Burn and Witch's Brew.
Do you know who stars in Witch's Brew, Dave? One of your favorites.
No, I don't
from
know.
From the 80s.
Helen Slater?
Terry Garr.
Oh, I love Terry Garr.
Do we have Terry Garr as an actorist overview yet?
We do.
Of the two, I liked Weird Woman the best.
I like them both quite a lot.
Okay.
For different reasons.
Let's talk about...
Inner Sanctum?
Inner Sanctum. Did you look that up at all?
It was a radio program, and I've heard a few of them. Not extensively. It's not one of the radio shows that I've listened to the entire catalog of or anything like that, but I've heard some. They're good fun. I think they probably all do start, although maybe I'm being influenced by the movie, they probably do all have that narrator who appeared to us inside a crystal ball at the beginning.
I don't know if it's the same person doing it.
No, but the same idea.
Sure. Not the same effect on radio.
It's so crazy, the start of the movie.
From the article on Inner Sanctum, the complete movie collection on DVD, according to the TCM article that you can find attached to the Weird Woman entry, one of the things that really made the radio series that was launched by NBC in 1941 was host Raymond Edward Johnson. With arch menace and tongue-in-cheek wit, Raymond introduced each production. His droll charisma seated a generation of followers, from famous monsters Forry Ackerman to Elvira, and the many regional horror hosts who kept gothic horror alive with TV returns of Universal Studios classics. But yeah, this movie is made with style.
Reginald Borg, who knew?
Introduction is really surreal.
It's basically saying, you know, any of you out there could be a murderer.
And apparently that was the tagline for every one of these Inner Sanctum Universal productions, all of which starred Lon Chaney Jr.
Right.
You know, in not monster roles. They weren't a monster series.
I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that I really liked Lon Chaney Jr. in this professor role.
It was a terrific casting for him, much like Son of Dracula. Similar, too. Also from that article, the formula was simple. Lon Chaney Jr. plays a respected member of the community, usually some kind of doctor, caught in a torrid love triangle. A mysterious death brings suspicion on Chaney. Wildly outsized characters and seemingly paranormal events take up a few reels before the extraordinary goings-on are revealed to be hoaxes. Wrap it all up with a last-minute twist and try not to use up more than 60 minutes on the way. These were B-pictures, after all, distributed on the lower half of double bills paired with more ambitious fare. The six films worked minor variations on this formulaic understructure, but did so with ample atmospherics and style. Agreed for this one. Compared to some of the dreary stuff the studio was doing over on the monster lot, Mummy Curse, I'm looking at you. These are spry little nuggets of entertainment, better than they should be.
Oh yeah, I agree. All those rubber mask monster movies, this is way better. This is more in the Val Lewton tradition a little bit.
Absolutely. I felt like this particular entry was attempting something Lewton-esque and actually not doing a bad job, not falling far short.
No, it's not as good as the Val Lewton movies, but it was really good. I was riveted.
And particularly it's playing around with ideas from Cat People, and we can talk about that. So these Inner Sanctum mysteries seem to have been very much forgotten by most horror fans, most Universal horror fans. In fact, I read some things online that were very dismissive of this movie.
Yeah, well, that was the impression I got. That's why I passed on the box set in 2006.
This one is generally considered to be a standout, this particular movie, so we lucked into that. We picked this on no basis other than wanting to pair a woman title with Cobra Woman. So very pleasantly surprised.
We should expand on the cast list because nobody mentioned some of the other people that are in it. Elizabeth Risden was amazing in this movie as the Dean of Women. I love that actress, and this is one of the biggest roles I've ever seen her in. She plays Priscilla Lane's mom in Roaring Twenties. She's in lots of very small little roles like that. She always impresses as a very tender-hearted, sympathetic person. Here, she is that, but she's also hard as nails in a lot of ways and just laying down the law about who's a fraud at the university and who is someone that she is going to go to bat for when they're accused of sexual misconduct. Evelyn Ankers, everyone did mention, and yes, we've seen her before because she is the good girl in Son of Dracula, but here she's got a much meatier role as a complete maniac.
Yeah, the one thing that is mentioned in the production notes on Wikipedia is she found playing a villainess difficult and everybody kept bursting into laughter laughter when she was filming these scenes.
Yeah, because she always plays such a sweet, vulnerable character.
But she's great in this movie and is kind of the protagonist along with Lon Chaney Jr.
And Elizabeth Russell, so there's the callback, the explicit callback to Val Lewton. She is the Moya Sestra cat person.
And you know who she reminded me of from the first shot of her in that window, and then throughout the movie, both in performance style and physically, was Grace Zabriskie.
Oh, yeah.
In Twin Peaks and some other, well, particularly in Twin Peaks. You see it?
Yeah. There's also Lois Collier, who's really fun in this movie as the love-struck grad student. She's in Cobra Woman as well. Did you notice? She is the woman who winds up taking over the island when everyone else is either killed or leaves. So she's like the assistant to the queen. Harry Hayden is in this. He's in all the Preston Sturges movies. He plays Mr. Waterbury in Christmas in July. The write-ups did mention Ralph Morgan, so that's Frank Morgan's less dynamic brother, who plays the guy that is beset by anxiety.
I can see the resemblance. He's good in what he has to do here.
Oh, yeah.
This is a movie very dominated by women, other than Lon Chaney Jr. spending all his time worrying about that.
Yeah, it's really quite a feminist text in a lot of ways, because the rationalist protestations of Lon Chaney are kind of undercut at many places here. It doesn't feel that much like a Scooby-Doo adventure. Well, like, some of it is explainable and some of it is not.
You know, of course, that the original Gothic novels, it's not just Scooby-Doo. The original Gothic novels were also...
Everyone gets exposed as...
Everything gets explained away by the end of the novel. The Anne Radcliffe novels.
Right.
But Conjure Wife, Fritz Lieber is a well-known...
Yeah, he's a sci-fi writer. I've read a couple of his books at some point.
Sci-fi, fantasy, and horror. This was his first novel. The premise of the novel is, as Wikipedia puts it, that witchcraft flourishes as an open secret among women. So everybody's a witch in this novel. There's nothing about bringing home a wife who's been raised according to...
Polynesian practices.
Yeah, so this is another... Are they both supposed to be South Sea Islands? No, Cobra Island is just made up.
Yeah, it's very hard to understand where Cobra Island is.
Actually, no. So Wikipedia says Cobra Woman is a 1944 South Seas adventure film.
Yeah, okay, they say that, but what's a chimpanzee doing there? I mean...
They've got the South Seas on the brain in Universal this year. So that is all added to the story, and it's unclear why this sociology professor in the movie also collects... all of these so-called primitive culture or aboriginal artifacts.
Well, he's obviously focused on anthropology, and sociology and anthropology are combined departments at many universities.
Okay. Maybe that's also true of the original novel, so maybe the husband in the novel also had an interest in witchcraft from an anthropological viewpoint, who knows?
Yeah, and examining atavism.
This additional idea for the movie, I think, really adds value to it above the plot of the novel.
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, what it also changes is the fact that there's only one so-called witch who's practicing white magic, so the atavism theme becomes a comment on who's the real witch.
Oh, yeah. Who is the weird woman in this story?
Yeah. And have we really gone as far in becoming rational beings as Lon Chaney Jr.'s professor would like to believe?
He hesitates on that. By the end, he's like, are we going two steps forward, one step back? Are we going one step forward, two steps back?
Well, the way in which he is a noir hero, he's this freaking out, sweaty individual.
Voiceover.
Even though he's a professor. Well, the voiceover was apparently carried over from the radio series.
Right.
At Lon Chaney Jr.'s insistence.
Well, yeah, it fits perfectly.
For all of the entries, he gets to have this voiceover. So yeah, he's just unraveling the whole time in voiceover and having these obsessive compulsive thoughts about whether rationality is going to prevail and whether, by the end, whether rationality is even correct.
And again, in this one, it's less explicit, I would say, than in Cobra Woman. But the idea here, sociologists would have been particularly obsessed with the tendency and potential of human societies during the conflict with fascism. Are we going to be inevitably consumed by atavism and fascism and these horrifying urges to destroy each other and tear each other apart rather than working together and solving problems rationally?
The political commentary is much more buried, particularly in Weird Woman. There's no overt political commentary in either.
There's a lot of office politics or academic politics. I wasn't expecting that.
But you're probably right that there is a trace of it here, more overtly in Cobra Woman. There was also the anti-immigrant and xenophobic attitude of Elizabeth Russell toward Anne Gwynne's character.
Now, she's easily swayed to begin believing that Anne Gwynne is at the heart of all of the evil when it's clearly Evelyn Ankers.
Well, and she's actually telling her, go home, go home, go home at one point.
Yeah.
So she gets scapegoated. I don't know why they decided to do this, but it has an interesting effect that they make Paula a white woman.
They were not allowed to have interracial relationships on screen.
At certain points, a South Sea Islander and a white man could have had relations on screen in Hollywood movies.
Yeah, before the enforcement of the code.
So that's true? Even that King Vidor fantasy, that was pre-code?
Yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't sure how strict they were. Obviously, black and white relationships were strictly policed on screen, but I wasn't sure how much of a stickler the code was.
The code was an intensely racist document.
Well, what about Native American Jennifer Jones in Duel in the Sun? She's punished, but I mean, it's definitely implied that she's having a relationship with Gregory Peck's character.
Yeah, but they basically treat it like they committed a crime.
Well, I mean, if you're doing a superficial reading of the movie, I don't think King Vidor is treating it that way.
No, but for the censors, they can think of it that way. That this is doomed, it's bad.
Well, that's what I'm saying. They end up dead. You could definitely think that this was a mismarriage, though, for most of it.
No, but they wind up fine.
Completely unbelievably.
Sure.
I haven't seen such a tacked on false happy ending since Autumn Leaves. It reminded me of Autumn Leaves. It's fine. Psychiatry has triumphed and everything's going to be roses from now on.
Well, you just know something else is going to come up to cause them to work at cross purposes again.
The ending's just a lie. It's just a joke.
Exactly.
It's a joke made by the filmmakers.
Lon Chaney Jr., so much is just his own self-talk in this movie, and his wife has to deal with it too, unfortunately.
So from the very beginning, we see what a bumbling fool Lon Chaney Jr. is.
It's a flashback, because we start out actually with very moody nighttime scene. A woman has been prowling around in the middle of the night. Is she a weird woman? Is she doing something bad? Everyone's watching. The neighbors see. Elizabeth Russell notices. Lon Chaney Jr. is in his study writing up a book on how we're going to solve all of our problems rationally. Superstition is gone. But when he starts to think back about their first meeting, we see he's in his pith helmet and wandering around in the jungles.
And we also see that his study is filled with
Orientalist artifacts.
So-called primitive artifacts and, subsea island African-style masks and religious artifacts. My favorite part is we're viewing all of these. Of course, the contrast between the fact that he has chosen to surround himself by these signifiers of irrationality in modern Western culture, yet he's having this monologue about how he's a hyper-rationalist. I mean, we're already led to question that. When he was touring and showing us all of these artifacts that he was looking at, then the camera suddenly lands on one that just looks like an alien head. Like a science fiction alien head. So that was another great surrealist moment in the movie.
Should have brought back the guy in the crystal ball. His meet cute with Anne Gwynne, he comes very close to getting himself killed because as an anthropologist / sociologist, he should at least understand that societal norms are societal norms, whether you agree with them or not. And he's informed directly that he should not cross this line because he's offering himself up to be sacrificed if he does.
He's watching a ceremony, but he's just bumbling all over the place, just interrupting them, not asking any questions about what's going on. Now, we should say, first of all, that South Sea Island traditions are being absolutely misrepresented here, I'm sure, but also it's being associated with movie voodoo, which is Haitian, which is from the Caribbean, but also voodoo dolls are not particularly voodoo. They aren't really a significant part of voodoo, which is what I keep hearing and encountering now. They had more to do with European witchcraft.
Yeah, as always, this is a ridiculous mishmash that has nothing to do with any extant or formerly extant culture.
Right, and so that is insulting and propagates, it's a complete misrepresentation, which is the place where the movie falls down because otherwise it is treating this subject very intelligently. But accuracy is not, the movie works according to big, broad tropes. Accuracy would not be in any kind of service of these pulp tropes anyway. No. So we have to be sophisticated about watching the movie.
And within the world of the movie, however, these people do have these beliefs, and he's disregarding all of them, taking his life into his own hands. And only Anne Gwynne's intervention, it seems, saves him, because he becomes deathly ill. Somehow she stops him from throwing him into the sacrifice pit or whatever he was agreeing to by crossing the line. He gets so excited by this encounter with this girl whom he had known because he knew her father in the old days, and he just goes to give her a hug and crosses the line.
And at that point, we know that this is not a trustworthy protagonist.
No, he's a big oaf.
And we should be placing our, and I think we do, we are expected to, by the movie, to place our confidence in the rationality of Anne Gwynn's character. Now, she tells him that her father was a professor of anthropology on the island, but he died and she was raised by her nurse. Okay, already we have some interesting class commentary, the fact that her nurse was a native woman who, within her own community, holds a high position of high priestess, but she has to work as a nurse for white people.
Yeah.
So she raises this girl in the traditions of the island.
Yeah, and Paula accepts them completely, and she believes, and the movie at various points does make it seem like her beliefs are not misplaced. I mean, what she's doing does seem to help at various points, and it certainly doesn't hurt anyone.
Now, I said European witchcraft, but the better way to put that, the more up-to-date and accurate way to put that, is European folk magic. And so we have here represented as these people's beliefs what, as far as I know, and I'm by no means any kind of expert on this, but as far as I know, is more similar to European and maybe other cultures as well, folk magic, using so-called white magic to combat bad spirits and people who are working against you. I don't know how accurate a representation even of folk magic that is, but that's what we're presented here as the belief set. Obviously, the high priestess is working on the side of white magic.
We've got this couple, this opposites attract kind of situation.
Yeah, very cat people, right?
Absolutely. Now, I did love Lon Chaney Jr. in this movie, but I think Kent Smith would have been even better.
No, Lon Chaney is great for this movie. I don't think Kent Smith would have been better. He just presents different qualities. Lon Chaney is great as very kind of sincere, very genuine, weak-willed oaf.
Yeah. Now, he is a respected academic.
And he's perfect as an academic. Don't you believe this character as an academic?
Yeah. What is this movie's ultimate opinion of academia? I mean, the...
Pretty low. Pretty low. And this is coming from the book, I guess. Look, but the idea is that this movie is taking a sociological / anthropological view of the ivory tower and showing that this is the way societies can work as a whole.
Yeah, exactly. It is a sociology of the academy,
yeah,
rather than of any other cultures anywhere else in the world.
Yeah, and of course, the academy is supposed to represent the best and the most rational and the most educated of us, the most civilized, the most advanced.
We find those qualities sorely lacking, unfortunately, in this milieu.
We've talked before about how some of these B-movies seem to be possibly, we don't know what the filmmakers' intentions were, but possibly they're accidentally deconstructing racist tropes. This movie is very consciously deconstructing racist tropes.
Yeah, I agree. Do we know anything about Reginald LeBorg's?
Not a damn thing. He seems to just be a B-movie director.
He was Austrian, though.
He was a banker in Vienna who came to the United States as a visitor in 1928, 29, and 30, emigrated permanently in 1931.
So clearly not a fan of fascism.
You think at that time that would be the moment to leave for somebody who saw how things were going?
Yeah, well, Austria was also being run by fascists. There were some anti-Nazi fascists running Austria, and Dollfuss was the president for the early 30s, and then Nazis assassinated him, and Austria got absorbed into the Greater Reich a little later on, but the tendencies were certainly there. Oh, San Diego, I Love You, he directed that. It's amazing, that movie.
Buster Keaton movie? Oh no, he's in a supporting role.
Well, Edward Everett Horton is actually the star. He is the patriarch of a family.
Based on the titles of the majority of these movies on his selected filmography, though, it seems to have been a B-movie career.
Yeah.
But maybe they're all intelligent. Who knows? We also have a screenplay by Brenda Weisberg, a Russian-American screenwriter, worked on the Dead End Kids series, and also several films for Rusty the Dog. This is who's working at Universal on the B-movies. They have a B-movie team. But she was born in the Ukraine to a Jewish family and emigrated to Ohio as a little girl, so she would know something about, I guess, feeling like an outsider.
Well, pogroms, for sure.
And also feeling like an outsider in Ohio. It's fascinating doing this podcast and finding these little movies. We don't find that many really great gems, but finding these movies with no reputation, B-movies with no reputation, and discovering with what intelligence some of them were made.
How do you feel this one stacks up to Mad Doctor of Market Street?
Better.
Yeah, I think it's really, really good.
I mean, I feel this is almost as good as the best Lewton movies.
It's getting up there, yeah. And I mean, a big part of it is the intelligent writing for so many of the characters. Again, I love Elizabeth Risden's character, the Dean of Women.
The other thing is that you never, even in Val Lewton, you never see, obviously they're taking this straight from the novel, but you never see movies about academics or academic politics, like about universities. You don't see that in a movie of this era, ever. And you don't hear people in movies talking like they are professors or employees in a university, like these people are.
The last time we had anything this in-depth about the politics of academia was the remake of DOA, which also concerned a filched dissertation or plagiarized dissertation.
This reminds me a little bit, too, of this, but I like this better, that 50s movie about the couple working at the psychiatric asylum?
The Cobweb.
Yeah, The Cobweb, which was also very self-consciously doing what this movie is doing, studying a sort of academic setting as a microcosm of humanity or of society. This movie was more fun.
Or a supposedly enlightened professional environment anyway, which is no less insane than any other human milieu.
Right.
When you actually look at it closely.
What all happens after he gets her back to America?
That welcome home party. This is what Anne Gwynne walks into, and Lon Chaney Jr., although does he ever really walk into anywhere because he's so dazed that he's kind of wherever he is alone with himself.
And again, probably this is from the novel, but all of these women are running the lives and careers of these utterly befuddled men.
The tone is set so early on when you see Anne Gwynne gets home, takes off her muddy shoes, goes up to her room, and she's got a picture of Lon Chaney Jr. on her desk as if this is a man that anyone is going to find intrinsically attractive.
Yeah, and they have their separate bedrooms too, and he's way older than she is, which actually, because he's kind of out of shape, it actually registers in this movie as abnormal and not just the usual Hollywood norm.
Likewise, Ralph Morgan is way older than Elizabeth Russell, who's, you know, pushing him to write an academic treatise or a monograph and get ahead and become chair of the department.
Which, of course, probably would be quite normal, not only for any marriage, but maybe particularly for academic marriages at the time.
And Elizabeth Risden, again, the Dean of Women, laughing about how everyone's jockeying for this chair position.
Except for Lon Chaney Jr., who's just, like, checked out.
Some doctoral student fortuitously dies. Nobody else has seen the dissertation, so he just publishes it under his own name.
Right, because he's so desperate to please his wife.
Exactly. But of course, at the center of this party and of the drama going forward is Evelyn Ankers.
I think we do have the sense, too, that the age discrepancy between them has something to do with him needing to be a big man on campus for her.
Now, Evelyn Ankers, she welcomes Lon Chaney back as if they're a couple still, and it is pretty shoddy of him, if they were dating, for him not to have at least warned her with a letter.
This Professor Norman Reed is an absolute asshole with women.
Yeah, he is.
It's just like when he stumbles over that line, he's just so absolutely rude and blunt. He informs her. I think it's probably true from what we see of her that all he's done is injure her vanity.
Yeah, she doesn't seem to have been madly in love with him in any normal way.
No, it's not like, what was that Dorothy McGuire movie, Invitation, where the woman actually does seem to have harbored delusional beliefs about the relationship. No, that's not, that kind of delusion is not this woman's problem. So she's in charge of, I don't know if it's just the department's library, probably, it's small, right? That's where their flirtation, as he calls it, started.
Yeah, and they dated. That's all true. But there was no understanding between them about getting married, as far as he's concerned. And he says, like, look, just drop it. Can't we just be friends? This happens all the time. You know, I met Anne Gwynne, fell in love with her. Case closed. We're married. And she's...
Case not closed.
No, she wants to reopen the case.
She's more like the woman from that other Dorothy McGuire movie, right? That everyone expected, including the man's mother, the doctor's mother, expected him to marry, who shows up to make trouble.
Mother didn't tell me.
Yeah, that's it. She doesn't even want him back, though. She wants him dead or worse.
Well, it's unclear exactly what she's trying to do, but it gets more and more psychotic as it goes along.
I think she's actually, yeah, she's, okay, well, she's trying to mess up his life in every way, and it will not stop even at prompting people to try to kill him or having him be blamed for murder.
She goes back and forth because she does want him back. She wants to volunteer to be his assistant on the book.
Yeah, but this gossip campaign against him doesn't start until after he rejects that.
Yeah, exactly. That's her first plan. She thinks, okay, well, it's an infatuation with this wife. If I work side by side with him all day long for a while, we'll get back to where we were. He'll divorce his wife and we will resume our courtship. But when he says, no, I really want Lois Collier, the grad student, to be my assistant. I don't want to work side by side with you. It's a bad idea. I'm married. Can you please remember that? Then yeah, after that, all bets are off. Can't get him back. Well, I'm going to destroy his life and anyone else that dies in the process, that's fine.
And usually this would be a very, very misogynist plot. Except that she is so much fun in this role, and he is, his whole demeanor is just asking for this.
Yeah, and again, the fact that the only people in the movie with agency and who are thinking about the grand scheme of things, they're all women.
Yeah, which I think is taken, that idea, it comes from the novel.
Right,
yeah.
So it's not just, here's one bad woman. There is a bad woman in this movie, for sure. And then all the other real agents are women as well. And Lon Chaney just at the center of this, wandering around in a daze.
Wander around worrying about whether witchcraft is real or not.
Yeah, and how best to be rational, and why can't everyone just be rational?
Even as he goes more and more crazy.
Yeah, and he has good reason to be driven insane, because things do really start to pile up on him. He's accused of sexual misconduct. You know, certainly in the era of Me Too, we could take exception to the way that that's all presented, because it's dismissed.
Yeah, I don't think these conversations in private in universities go much differently than this one here. I guess maybe you'd have a whole committee on it now.
Right.
But the private conversation between the person who was alerted and the star professor, I bet this is quite still an accurate representation. Well, the girl's a neurotic. Yeah, well, tell me what actually happened. What went down?
Yeah, Elizabeth Risden, her decision is final. When she decides, okay, I believe Lon Chaney, I don't believe this woman.
Yeah, there's no committee, there's no HR.
No. She's like, I'll handle it, don't worry, don't worry. Of course, before she can handle it, the most irrational maniac in the whole movie is this guy David.
When Lon Chaney first calls him a psychopathic boy, I just laughed out loud, because he hadn't really done anything psychopathic yet, but he proves to be correct.
Doesn't take him much to be pushed to the point of showing up at the gym with a gun to blow Lon Chaney away.
So at this point in 1944, the language of psychiatry is deemed the vanguard of rationality. I don't know how we'd feel. We certainly wouldn't feel that way about psychotherapy now.
But we should look at what happens to David. He thinks, I'm engaged to Lois Collier, who seems like way out of his fucking league. She's much better looking than he is. Much more intelligent.
That does not matter in this movie. These women do expect to get star professors.
He's pushed aside. She starts spending all of her time with her professor. She tells him, I know you've been hanging out just waiting for me at the library, but you can't do that anymore when I'm working for Lon Chaney Jr.
And as far as I'm concerned, this is a wholly accurate portrait of undergraduates, graduate students getting infatuated with star professors. Any professors.
It can happen, sure.
It happens all the time.
And I'm sure it happens the other way too. It's just that there aren't that many female professors to get obsessed with, although there are more and more.
I doubt that it happens the other way very frequently. That's not the society we live in.
So David's been dissed that way.
Also, Evelyn Ankers is feeding this infatuation, trying to get Lois Collier to believe there's a chance here.
Yeah, you're exactly the kind of girl that can inspire a professor to greatness, can spur him on. And David is told all of this too.
There is something going on with them, she's telling him.
And then when, at a very stressful moment in his life, after Ralph Morgan has killed himself, that's where Lois Collier tries to seize her moment. She grabs his arm and she wants to comfort him. And he's just standing there thinking about his problems. When he finally realizes what's going on, it takes him a long time.
And again, he's just a complete oaf about
he's
it.
He's like, well, you get off me, you weird woman! And he doesn't call her that, but that's basically how he acts.
He tells her to get out. Practically has to throw her out, as he tells the Dean of Women later.
Yeah, and then David comes in because he bumps into Lois Collier, who says that he's a philanderer, which is delusional as well. So he's like, I'm going to go finally reclaim my manhood here. But he's tiny next to Lon Chaney, gets bodily shoved around. And that's it, right? At that point, his psychopathic tendencies take over. And he's like, well, I can't beat him up. I have to go kill him with a gun. That's my only option.
But you know, psychiatry might be the language of rationality, but what it's identifying is that all of these seemingly civilized middle-class people are all completely irrational.
Well, that's what the head in the crystal ball told us. We are as well.
You're entering the Inner Sanctum, a realm controlled by a big ball of goo called the mind. No, what is it? Throbbing flesh? Something flesh of the mind.
Monsters from the id. One nice aspect of all of this is that some of the women who are on the weird side sort of come back. So Elizabeth Russell, she has a whole arc because, yes, her xenophobia, her ambitions get her husband killed, basically, when he's caught in the crossfire of all of these schemes. And she's the shock troop for ordering Anne Gwynne out of town. She's the one that shows up. She knows about the phone calls and she's kind of in on it. She's trying to force Anne Gwynne to answer the phone so she can hear these death chants. When she and Lon Chaney confront each other and it all comes out, she realizes she's been a cat's paw in Evelyn Anker's grand scheme and she joins the good team.
Meanwhile, though, is the supernatural real or not front of things? The suicide happens right after Lon Chaney Jr. forces his wife to destroy all of her
charms.
Yeah, religious accoutrements or charms.
Especially that amulet. That's the most important one.
The amulet that she got from the woman who raised her. To me, watching this scene, first of all, him particularly asking her to destroy that amulet is a total violation.
Yeah.
Of not just her personal beliefs, but her identity.
I agree.
And also, you're kind of worried about what the consequences are going to be for them, and that turns out to be correct. For the whole rest of the movie, so Cat People was 1942. What's fascinating is that because of the persona of Lon Chaney Jr., he seems very vulnerable, despite being this giant oaf, right, who can get rough physically if he has to. He seems very vulnerable throughout, and after he destroys these charms, I think we are fearing for him. He is the woman in the picture. All of this evil is being directed toward him,
yeah.
And she is the one who's been protecting him, and without her protections, he is extremely vulnerable, and I feel like that scene with him in the gym, that really stylish scene where he's punching the punching bag and he keeps thinking one step forward, two steps back, one step forward, two steps back. He's freaking out. He's losing his grip on reality. It reminded me of the scene where the rival woman goes swimming in Cat People, right?
Yeah, the punching bag becomes kind of like a social regression metronome. And then David shows up with the gun and they have a scuffle. David gets killed. He doesn't get killed right away, but he gets grievously wounded by the gunshot, and that's hanging over Lon Chaney. He gets brought in by the police. The great Elizabeth Risden bails him out. If he dies, well, it's going to get even worse. If he dies, they have to prove that someone else has been pulling the strings behind the scene. The only way they can do that is by turning the tables on Evelyn Anker's and making her believe that the spirits are out to get her for what she's done.
Now we get into the Shakespearean psychology, because she's already ready, her guilt is ready to be triggered, because she has been acting in a completely irrational way, and as soon as she's accused in some way that feels religious, like she's being judged by supernatural forces, yeah, then she just starts completely unraveling. So we're familiar with noir, so now she becomes the noir protagonist.
It's sort of like what they do to Montgomery, to Robert Ryan in Crossfire. There's no supernatural element, but in that one, they get Floyd to approach Montgomery and pretend that he has seen someone who's supposed to be dead. He's like, yeah, he told me a crazy thing to tell you. This knowledge that only a dead person would have. In Crossfire, they've pieced it together through deduction, and it's actually the same thing in this one.
And there's that whole sequence where she keeps seeing by coincidence, and Lon Chaney Jr. has gone on about how coincidence is a way that rational, civilized people have rationalized superstitious fear.
If I resort to using the word or the concept of coincidence, that means I've already lost, because I don't believe that it could happen for any rational reason.
Which also makes me think, and probably someone on the team here, the writer, is thinking of Jung's synchronicity concept.
Right.
So she keeps seeing all of these coincidental things that are telling her that in 7 days she's going to die.
Yeah, she sees the numbers counting down.
And she sees a movie that says, I can't remember, but the words that were said in the curse that was put on her.
Right, right.
Right? The guilty one must die, something like that. The lying woman must die, something like that.
Because Elizabeth Russell says, well, the spirit that visited me said the liar is going to be held responsible and will die. Well, I didn't lie. Who's the liar? Evelyn Anchors is clearly the liar.
And what's interesting is that her character remains very opaque at the end of the movie. She doesn't seem crazy. So she really is a weird woman. Like, what was motivating her? It's like Iago. She doesn't have enough of a cause for what she does.
No, because what? Love of Lon Chaney Jr.? That's ridiculous.
It's not even love of him. It's just her vanity, like you said. It's like Iago.
Yeah.
It's all Shakespearean, guys. Shakespeare wrote the tropes, and B-movies are just living them.
Yeah, this is the kind of thing that would prey on her mind, because she hasn't lived her whole life this way, spurring people to kill themselves and spurring others to assault professors. She's taken extraordinary measures here. She's entered a realm that she was not prepared for and eventually pays the price with her death.
Was it Coleridge who talked about Iago having a motiveless malignancy?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, except that Iago is like totally committed to his malignancy all the way to the end. And no, this woman, it's kind of almost more interesting, the fact that it's Iago mixed with Macbeth. It's also playing on some themes from other well-known tragedies like Medea. In that case, well, Medea, the jilted woman, is the agent of Jason's tragedy, and the things that she does to the people in the story far outweigh even what's been done to her, although what's been done to her is pretty terrible because Jason promised to marry her after she helped him, and she is the witch in that story. But they're also reversing that trope, because instead of the protagonist jilting a witch from a foreign country who has helped him, he marries one, but she turns out to be a good witch in this case. And the Medea figure is the woman at home.
She sure is.
This movie has bottomless depths of sophistication.
Weird woman. Catch it. Let's hear from Clive Hirshhorn from the Universal Story on Cobra Woman. This one has a full write-up. More escapism in glorious technicolor from the team of Maria Montez, John Hall, and Sabu in Cobra Woman, with La Montez giving the paying customers added value for money by playing two roles, a sarong-clad native girl and her more ornately gowned high priestess sister. On the eve of her wedding to Hall, Montez is kidnapped and taken to her sister's island, with her fiancé following in hot pursuit. An erupting volcano brought Richard Brooks and Gene Lewis's screenplay, story by W. Scott Darling, to its climax, with sarong-clad Montez taking her rightful place as high priestess and being reunited with handsome John Hall as well. Robert Siodmak's direction kept it moving at a cracking pace, and there was serviceable support from Lon Chaney Jr., Mary Nash, Edgar Barrier, Lois Collier, Samuel S. Hines, and Maroni Olson. George Wagner produced 70 minutes. And just for symmetry, let's hear what Leonard Maltin had to say. He gives it 3 stars out of a possible 4. Camp classic, with Montez as twin sisters, one good, one evil. Technicolor fantasy escape of the 1940s at its zenith. Director Robert Siodmak cast Maria Montez, John Hall, Sabu, Edgar Barrier, Lois Collier, Lon Chaney Jr., Mary Nash. So La Montez.
Right. My first encounter. Yours too?
No, I've seen her once before in not one of the typical Maria Montez roles, but she has a great quasi-cameo role in the Ophuls movie, The Exile, and she's amazing in that movie. I fell in love with her immediately when I saw her in that and thought to myself, I should really see some of those Montez movies, even though I'm not typically drawn to quote-unquote camp classics.
Or technicolor fantasy adventures.
No, not usually.
So I actually went ahead and read avant-garde filmmaker Jack Smith's essay on Maria Montez. I'd heard about it for a long time. He was one of the many gay men coming of age in the 50s and 60s who idolized Maria Montez.
Watching her on TV, I imagine, because she was dead by 1951.
Yeah, apparently you could catch some of these movies occasionally in little theaters, too. It's a fascinating essay. Everybody should read it. But the legend that has attached to her, and that Jack Smith doesn't question as much as he worships her, is that she was one of the worst actresses of all time.
Yeah, that's weird, because
it is weird.
Perfectly fine in this movie.
This is not a role calling for great thespian abilities, but yeah, she's not worse than any other star in a fantasy adventure. Bosley Crowther, at the time, says, "The submissive audience is witchingly rocked to sleep with as wacky an adventure fable as was ever dished up outside the comic strips." And he also says, "Miss Montez plays dual roles, those of the good twin and the bad twin, without a trace of distinction between What is he talking about?
There's a great deal separating the two.
There is an enormous distinction between the two characterizations, both of which are very cartoonish, that is maintained in her split-screen scenes, so people are just delusional watching these films. Even at the time, what was causing this?
They just want to believe Maria Montez has nothing to offer except beauty, and they're going to go with that.
Apparently, in an interview from 1959, Siod Mack said of this film that it was silly but fun. Montez couldn't act from here to there, but she was a great personality and completely believed in her roles. If she was playing a princess, you had to treat her like one all through lunch, but if she was a slave girl, you could kick her around anyhow and she wouldn't object. Method acting before its time, you might say. I don't know if Smith read that. I'm not sure what exact year this essay was from. Oh, film culture 1962-63. So he could have read that.
Seems likely.
Because that's the kernel of his essay. This is basically what he says about Montez. Over and over and over that she couldn't act, but who cares, because she absolutely believed in everything she was doing on screen and therefore makes you believe.
Yeah, and what does it mean to say someone can't act? I mean, on the stage, I understand what it means.
For me, it means on the screen that someone is giving a totally wooden performance.
Yeah, and that's not the case.
That's
with
not
her.
What she's doing.
No, you believe that she is each of these characters. That's all you need.
Yeah, that's all you need for a comic strip movie, the plot of which, the various elements of the plots, reminded me even of the comic books, the superhero comic books I read in the 80s, because they were still using these tropes, which I guess were from pulp novels and comic strips before there were comic books.
Because bad acting in a movie, to me, means you are watching a movie and you cannot engage with it. All you can think about is that this person is miscast and is not convincing me that anything that is happening is happening on the screen.
Or they just can't read a line with any emotion.
Well, yeah, exactly. So it's drawing attention to the fact that this is just a pathetic product of a studio that took no care in assembling it and is offering someone that can't engage with your mind in any way.
Or sometimes somebody is just absolutely outstandingly weird, like that tiny role that we saw in one of the Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers movies. Remember that? That woman who just says a few lines in a window and sings a song, and we were like, who did she have to sleep with to get this role? Because she was just bizarre.
Oh, you're talking about the person that gets involved in singing The Continental.
That was just freakish.
The Continental! She can't really sing. That was the problem there.
Freakish in a way that isn't engaging.
Well, I think she's kind of like sub-Ethel Merman or something.
Well, she was singing. She couldn't sing, but also the singing was somehow wooden.
Yeah, that whole Continental number is a bit odd. That's the only unforgivable sin in a movie. You don't have to sustain a character the way you have to do through 20, 30 minute acts of a play. All you have to do is be captured by the camera and have the person watching it feel like, I'm okay with this. I'm watching something that is happening in this story.
In this world.
Exactly. Maria Montez satisfies 100% in both of her roles.
And of course, the greatest performance she gives in this movie and the greatest sequence in the movie is the evil twin Cobra dance and the expression on her face when she's dancing around and pointing and consigning villagers to death.
Yeah, just mass execution coming
up.
Just
mania just coming over her face. It's fantastic. It's way better than the Marlene Dietrich golden leg dance in Kismet.
And what's really interesting about it is we get to see her, you know, off stage, so to speak, in this movie, because she's not actually that crazy. But when she gets into the King Cobra mode, she just gets so amped up that she can't resist executing all these people. But she knows when she's talking to her advisor, the executor of the law, neither of them believe in any of the stuff they're doing, right? It's very clear they're using the atavism and the legend of the volcano for social control means. They don't actually think that there is any god that needs to be satisfied. So she's not doing it out of any inner need. She's doing it because she has to go up there and be a cruel, bloodthirsty ruler. That's the political pose that she has adopted to maintain her grip on power. Just like the real Maria Montez, she is a method actress and she gets more and more into it and orders more and more people to their deaths as she goes along.
Well, but he's also told her that more people have to be sacrificed because they're not bringing enough gold.
Yeah, exactly. None of it has to do with actual religious motivation.
No.
The closest thing I've ever seen to the way these guys are ruling this state, Cobra Island,
yeah,
it actually takes me back to the crazy independent comic book Cerebus, when he becomes Pope of the world without believing in any of the religious aspects of the job. He begins to abuse his office by ordering more and more tribute for Tarim, the god, and when people don't comply, he orders them into the plague-infested swamps to die.
Well, it's very possible that Dave Sim was inspired by this movie.
You never know. He does like old movies a lot.
Pretty famous movie. That leads me, though, that discussion leads me into, what did you understand about this world of Cobra Island, and did the world building make any sense?
It's an Oriental nightmare. This has nothing to do with any real societies. It's a political construct that is introduced to us to contemplate and to watch in action.
Now, they're fully xenophobic to begin with. Let's try to figure this out. So first of all, the queen and the high priestess, it's difficult to say who is the actual ruler here.
One of them is the head of state and the other is the head of government, it seems. So the queen is the head of state, but the person who's really running the government is the high priestess.
Okay, does that make sense in terms of real society analogs?
Could. Yeah, it could. So the queen, she has some power, and they can't, well, until the enforcer of the law guy decides to just go in and kill her, which is not, no one else seems to have considered doing that before. She has real power and she can influence the people one way or another, but she doesn't control what actually happens on a day-to-day basis. That's the high priestess, because she's in direct contact with the gods in the volcano, according to the beliefs of the society. And she has that power because she passed a test as a baby when they had her bitten by a cobra, survived.
And this other twin sister,
she's the rightful ruler, because
she's the rightful ruler. So the high priestess, it's not that these two seized power. The high priestess is always supposed to be the really effective ruler.
Yeah, because they had twins, that threw a monkey wrench and everything. So both were bitten by a cobra, and it seemed like, you know, the good Maria Montez, baby that grows up to be the good Maria Montez, was going to succumb to her bite. And so they figured, she's too weak, we're going to take the other one and raise her to be the high priestess. But because the good Maria Montez baby didn't die, they didn't know what to do with her, so they gave her to this Scottish corsair who happened to be there and was on the block to be executed. Queen, I guess, discovered she had a use for him. She said, okay, well, usually strangers get killed here, but you just go away, take the good Maria Montez and raise her as your daughter. We'll call it even.
So the queen actually has these religious beliefs. And she talks about the law about strangers dying predating her.
Yeah, she doesn't agree with it, obviously, because she's hanging out with these strangers without killing them. But she's like, you know, we work within certain constraints. You know, it's always been the way. We kill anyone that shows up on Cobra Island.
And she obviously believes in King Cobra as a good god, as the god that she worships, because when that guy's going to kill her, she talks about how King Cobra and the mountain will know. But then what kind of sense does it make at the end that King Cobra is killed? And obviously also the good Maria Montez isn't able to interact with this god.
No, but King Cobra is the god, like in the volcano. That actual big cobra was just an avatar.
But they say that they've killed King Cobra.
Yeah, but it's not. It's like an avatar, right? The god is still extant. The god lives in the volcano.
Yeah, and at the end they say that the god in the volcano is happy. So have they killed a false representation then of King Cobra?
Yeah.
I was just trying to figure out, does this make any sense at all? Is it all just a jumbled heap of contradictions that don't make any sense?
No, I think it makes enough sense. Like, okay, maybe there is a god in the volcano, but that doesn't mean that the structure that people have built around this reality to make decisions and run society, it seems to have gotten off track. And they're paying way too much attention to this actual cobra, which is not a god.
The rightful and good high priestess is not capable of serving this god. So something's wrong here.
What Maltin doesn't mention, what nobody mentioned, is that neither Maria Montez winds up running the country, because the bad one dies and the good one goes back to modernity with John Hall on the ship.
But they had to get rid of this cobra, clearly. Yeah.
And Lois Collier takes over, who is not part of the royal family at all, right? She is just going to be a good ruler.
So, yeah, so the idea then is, whether the world building makes sense or not, and I'm not sure that it does, we can still say that the idea is the trope, the comedy what Northrop Frye would call the comedy or romance, and this is a fantasy adventure is a type of romance, or another name for romance. The comedy or romance trope here is of the bad law that has to be suspended or defeated at the end of the story so that a happier society can come into being.
Yeah, and in this case that means, you know, having someone come to power who earned it by being intelligent and empathetic. And we've seen that the whole way through. Lois Collier does come across as a great character. She's certainly far more intelligent and aware of her surroundings than the character she played in Weird Woman, who is just an obsessed grad student who throws herself at her professor.
And of course, makes no sense whatsoever that only she and Sabu, these two juvenile characters, speak broken English.
Well, that's a real problem with the movie, of course. And
the movie's got so many problems along those lines, there's no point in even isolating it, but it is ridiculous.
But a countervailing tendency that it's worthwhile pointing out. Now, Sabu was a star, very charismatic actor.
An Indian actor.
Comes to prominence in the Jungle Book movie. He's in, like, The Thief of Baghdad, and he's in a bunch of other movies. Now, probably the greatest movie he ever appeared in is Black Narcissus, where he plays a sympathetic prince. He doesn't have a major role in it, but he's present through quite a few scenes. And here, he's the eager sidekick to John Hall, but very sympathetically treated. I mean, the movie actually cares deeply about whether he gets hurt, and his friendship with John Hall is kind of heartwarming. You know, like they really care about each other.
Just a little bit homoerotic.
You know,
they're not wearing many clothes in this movie.
When they really care about each other. John Hall is constantly helping him out of danger, and he helps John Hall as well.
Yeah, we see way more of them together than we do of him with the good Maria Montez.
That's true. And Sabu actually saves the day. I mean, he's the one that kills the giant cobra.
Yeah, with Chekhov's dart gun.
Which he also used to kill a Black Panther. Without Sabu, everybody's dead in this movie.
Yeah, of course. But he's also, you know, colonized. He's a Christian, as is mentioned at many points.
He talks a lot about how he was raised by a Catholic father. I thought they were building up towards a romance between Sabu and Lois Collier, because they spend a bunch of time together and they seem to like each other. But no, they didn't go that way, unfortunately.
Yeah, I thought so too. What do we need from Maria Montez here? We need her to play comic book characters. So we need her to be beautiful and to be likable when she's the good Maria, and to be really fucking nasty when she's a bad one. This is accomplished. She's not hammy or campy in either role.
No.
And she's absolutely deranged in the Cobra dance sequence. She is Mac really created something great there.
Yeah, I agree. I love the scene where she is swimming and her handmaidens are watching, and John Hall thinks that she's the good Maria Montez because he's tracked her down, jumps into the pool and accosts her and kisses her repeatedly, and she just goes along with it.
Yeah, she's like, oh, this handsome weirdo just showed up. Fine with that. We'll meet later. We'll meet, have a tryst.
And she's kind of unperturbed when she learns that he's being held for execution as well. But when he gets away, she's like, great, let's kiss some more.
Yeah, but as soon as he says, no, I don't want to have sex with you, that's the end of him.
Yeah, exactly. Once he realizes that she's not his intended, well, yeah, he doesn't want anything to do with her. And sure, she's mad at that point.
But of course, something interesting talking about how Sabu is the secret male protagonist is that he's like the good version of William Demarest at the end of The Lady Eve. He's the only one who can tell the difference. Between the two women. The male protagonist has a really hard time with this, telling which one is the good one and which one is the evil one. And he can't tell that this is his fiance imitating the bad twin, but Sabu can tell right away.
Yeah, he's like, no, Maria Montez can act perfectly well. One has a nice face and one has a mean face. Both beautiful.
And of course, I was thinking of the much, much later use of this trope, which is dopey good guy protagonist Riley sleeping with Faith, pretending to be Buffy with a magic spell in Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and that's when you know that Riley's not going to last.
No, Riley was a mistake.
But here it's just one more indication of Universal treating their male protagonists as dopes.
Interesting. John Hall, I really like John Hall in this movie. I thought he was excellent.
Mm-hmm. He's likable.
He bookends 1944 because we saw him in Paramount 1944. He plays the movie star guy in Lady in the Dark.
Oh, right. He's kind of an affable oaf in that, too.
Wants Ginger Rogers to come back to Hollywood with him and be his mother.
Right. He was great in that.
Take care of his affairs. In this one, he's more intrepid. He's ready to go to Cobra Island and face an entire people to get his girlfriend back.
Sure, but he doesn't recognize her at the end and he doesn't save the day.
No, he doesn't. But he's certainly everything that the good Maria Montez wants. She elects to come back with him rather than rule justly over her people. And the movie says that's perfectly fine because Lois Collier is going to do it. And she's been trained by the Queen all these years and she's going to be the best one.
They're almost like the good Kirk and the bad Kirk.
Yeah.
Maybe she really is too weak to rule the people, and the other one is way too extreme, and they just need these sisters to just get out.
Yeah, the scene where she is terrified by that cobra, I mean, that's not what you want in the ruler. You want the ruler who can face down this cobra. But there is such a thing as being too maniacal and too eager to face down the cobra. If you're that overpowering with the cobra, you may be too overpowering with your people as well and start killing them all. And be an insane fascist.
Yeah, so these sisters are just not going to work out as rulers at all. All right, did you want to say anything else? What about Lon Chaney Jr. in this movie?
Well, he doesn't speak at all.
It's a pretty important role, though.
It is, and he does shove some people around, and he gets to have a fun scene with Sabu at the beginning, where Sabu does all the talking for both of them and invents Lon Chaney Jr.'s half of the conversation.
This character is not afraid to kill people, even though he's one of the good guys. He kills a few people.
He does, yeah. Chimpanzee was good, too. I don't know what else to say about Lon Chaney Jr. I mean, yes, they use his physical presence well here. He's a giant oaf, again. He's like a golem. He's on the side of good. He's controlled by
the Queen,
the right people,
yeah,
the people that we care about. Mary Nash was terrific as the Queen.
Yeah, that deathbed scene, she had so much divine authority.
She did. And that's Katharine Hepburn's mother from Philadelphia Story. We've seen her this year as well because she's Eugene Pallett's wife in The Meantime, Darling.
Jack Smith is so defensive about this movie that he is very, very dismissive of that scene. And in fact, doesn't want any attention paid to the plot or dialogue at all. And this movie is a purely visual phenomenon, which is fine to emphasize, and I'm sure it would look great on the big screen, but no, I thought that was a really awesome dramatic scene, the murder of the Queen.
Yeah, me too.
It touched on some archetypal tropes there.
Yeah, Edgar Barrier was very sinister as Martok.
Martok.
You know, so much of his problem is that he's engaged to the evil Maria Montez, but she's clearly just settling for him. She's eager to switch John Hall into his place.
She doesn't want an evil vizier. She wants a hunky man.
Yeah, and he's really pissed off by that, and it just makes him act worse and worse. He gets overpowered by John Hall. He's getting unmanned left and right in this movie, and it drives him crazy. It drives him to just barge into the Queen's bedroom and straight up assassinate her. But she has kind of like an Obi-Wan Kenobi speech, right? If you strike me down, I'm going to become immensely more powerful than you ever dreamed. Which is kind of true, I guess, if you say that she merged with King Cobra in the volcano and everything worked out the way she wanted.
So what made you enjoy this movie more than, say, Star Wars?
Well, Maria Montez cannot be discounted. She was really appealing and frightening in her mania.
Yeah, absolutely. Agreed.
And the fact that she could do both of those things speaks volumes about her value as a screen performer. And I'm sure Jack Smith is right in whatever he said. There are many ways to be impressive on screen. And she is impressive in her own way.
Absolutely.
Not in a way that's going to win an Oscar, perhaps, but who cares about that?
But how many people get a chance to do a dual role? She must have loved that. That's usually reserved for
Olivia de Havilland or Betty Davis.
Edward G. Robinson. For the great actors of the screen. Nope, nope.
Well, look, Max Ophuls obviously saw something in her and he's like, I need her for The Exile. And he was right. She was amazing in that movie, which you didn't see. You need to see it one day.
Well, we're going to get to see her again pretty soon in a serious movie made in France with Lily Palmer.
Right, Hans Le Marin.
We'll see what we think of Maria Montez trying to be more serious.
Next week on the podcast, we return to Lily Palmer. We're going to be doing 3 movies, and that's going to happen a few times in the Lily Palmer series because when we initially created the schedule, there were a few movies that I thought we were just not going to be able to get, which by hook or by crook, I've managed to get a hold of. Hint, hint, just check out YouTube sometimes. Things are there that you never dreamed would be there. So we're going to be talking about Thunder Rock, The Gentle Sex, and English Without Tears next week.
Well, this is fine because these movies have been short so far, and so the episodes have been a bit short.
We'll see if that holds or if we go on an epic Lily Palmer excursion next week. See you then.